Hello, hello, and welcome back to the Musicians Talk Show podcast.
What's up, guys?
This is episode 15. We got a great guest for you guys. I'm super excited. As I am recording this, we just got off the phone with him, the mighty Tony McAlpine.
Yes, and it was awesome.
And it's a great episode. Guys, you have a lot to look forward to, and I'm not even going to tease what we talked about. It's just
true,
it's
insight
stuff. Yeah,
true insight.
Absolutely. So thank you guys for listening. We love you. We're so happy to be doing this podcast thing, and I'm gonna stop yapping and let's get to the value here. Tony McAlpine,
yeah,
let's
enjoy it.
Episode 15. We were actually just listening to Alien Hip Hop, and you know, by Planet X, of course, one of your amazing projects. I wanted to ask you, what was the writing process like for that song?
I had nothing to do with it. I don't even know.
Really? What was your contributions to Planet X in general?
Well, I mean, you know, for instance, that song was written by Virgil Donati. So, I mean, my contributions were to be a guitar player and a keyboard player. And I wrote some stuff, too, but that wasn't one of them.
Right. So, gotcha. Cool.
Yeah. Don't know. Well, don't know much about that tune.
Nice. I mean, Virgil writes some crazy stuff, so.
Yeah, he does.
Cool. So, yeah. I guess let's start from the top. How did you get started in music? What led you to music?
Well, I started playing music when I was 5 years old. I'm from the East Coast and started playing piano at the Springfield Conservatory of Music and remained there for about 18 years. And then I went to college at University of Hartford and played piano, and was a piano major at Hart College of Music. And along the way, I was, enamored with guitar and different instruments, you know, violin and just took the course of inspiration and study and to try to better myself as a musician, and led me down different roads, really, so to speak.
Okay, so what was you mentioned kind of college, right? I wanted to ask, what is your thoughts on going to music school versus not going to music school? And I mean, I think that's a big decision a lot of people are facing, and I think your advice might help some people.
Well, I mean, I might be biased. I wouldn't know, because I went to music school since I was five, and I don't know what it's like to not have done it. So if I knew both, then I would be a better, I could get better advice. But for me, you know, I was studying classical piano. So it's essential that you really have guidance and study. If you're learning stuff by ear, I don't really think that's really that big of a deal. But to learn to read and to interpret, you know, classics, yeah, it's something that you're really going to need. And that's what I was doing for the first 18, 20 years. I've come across lots of wonderful players that, you know, haven't even stepped foot or walked past a conservatory. They're doing just fine.
Right.
So I don't really think it's for everybody. I just think it's for whatever your particular needs are.
Okay. Yeah. That's a similar answer I've heard from a lot of people. So that's good to hear.
Yeah.
And kind of along that route, what about being in a big city, moving to Los Angeles, New York, Nashville? What does that offer for musicians? I mean, obviously, it offers the networking and stuff, but is that a necessity in today's climate?
Well, it depends on what your goal is. If you want to be a teacher, I would probably say not. I mean, but if you're looking to be a performer, what you're really trying to do is just raise your odds. You're trying to get more contacts. You're trying to be in a situation where more things will pop up and you'll be able to respond to them quickly. You know, it would be hard to get to an audition in Los Angeles if I lived in, let's say, Alaska. You know, it's things like that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah, so that's just kind of why people do, why it's become what it is. I mean, but certainly with the advent of where we're at today with computers and media and different things, you can virtually be anywhere. It's not so much a question of that, but it's just, I think it's really a reality of whether or not you want to rub elbows with the right people at the right times.
Right. That's what they say success is opportunity meet or preparation meets opportunity, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly. Yeah.
So you're in Los Angeles?
I am. I'm in Pasadena. Yeah.
Okay. Gotcha. Cool. Yeah. I mean, that seems to be where most of our interviews come from, is out in that way. So that answers itself right there.
Well, see, we're all rubbing elbows out here.
Yeah, always. So, the next thing I wanted to talk about was practice routines, because I mean, I'm sure most people know this, but you're not only a ridiculous guitar player, you're a ridiculous pianist as well. I mean, how are your practice routines? How do you do that? How do you get so good at two things when most people struggle to get good at one?
Well, I mean, I don't know, but I can tell you that I'm not the greatest practicer in the world. You know, I just am woodshedding. No, I mean, really what I'm doing a lot of is I align it with probably like my teacher. One of my teachers used to always tell me, it's like when you speak English or language, you know, you don't have to go back and keep studying the alphabet, you know,
right.
That's not really what you do. I'm in a situation that's a little different when I'm so-called practicing. I'm really, if I'm doing that, I'm learning probably a live set of music that we're going to be playing. Maybe I haven't touched on it in a while, so I'll have to relearn something that I might have recorded 800 years ago, you know, something like that.
Yeah.
But it's not really so much of going back and really, you know, yeah, starting from ground zero. I it's not really the case. Sometimes I take quite a while away from both instruments, you know, just to get a different perspective on them when I get back to them. That's always helpful too.
Right.
So it's really just a matter of I really just have always been known for being prepared. It's really all I'm really doing. And by that, I mean like learning, if it's not my project, if it's something else I'm doing, like a session, then I learned all the parts, you know, I'm aware of what the timing is and, you know, what the bass player is playing, all that stuff, the keys and all that kind of crap. And if it's a situation where it's my music, then, you know, I have to go back to that headspace that I was at when I recorded it and try to relearn it. And so I can, yeah, generally I find that when people come to concerts or tours, they like to see the solos that you played, you know, on the record. They don't want to hear you come and be in some other headspace. You know, they want to see live, whatever, you know, whatever you recorded. So, and that takes a bit of just revisiting. Really.
Yeah. I think particularly if it's something impressive and technical.
Yeah. Yeah. Because, you know, unlike a singer, it's great how singers can throw the mic at people and go, here, sing this.
Right.
Yeah, we can't do that with the guitar. Here, play that.
That would be hilarious, yeah. But we can't do that. That's a good point. So you have perfect pitch, correct?
Yes, I do. Yeah.
That's fascinating to me. Is that something you could kind of, well, first of all, could you share what perfect pitch is for listeners who may not know?
Well, perfect pitch can be your biggest nightmare. For one, but I think relatively speaking, it's just the ability to have an innate understanding of what pitches, intervals, and multi-clusters are. You're able to identify what these notes are without any reference to, which is probably what, pitch that isn't, people, if you pull out a tuning fork and tap an A, I'll just put it that way. You know, you can relate what other pitches are related to that, but you have with perfect pitch, you have this A built into your head. You have all these notes that are just there.
Right.
And it never wanes, but it can be a nightmare if you're on a plane, you know, and you're trying to listen to like, you know, your iPod or whatever you're trying to do, you know, your music, you'll hear the engines on the plane in another key bothering you. So it's hard to tune these things out, but yeah. And sometimes, you know, it's very difficult to, for instance, I did this session. I did a live thing with this band Hail, you know, with, you know, Scott Travis and Tony Franklin and, you know, Vinnie Moore was actually there too. And it was in New Zealand. And these guys really wanted me to play on a tuned, you know, a guitar that was like basically tuned down.
Right.
Which was a nightmare for me. Because, you know,
that was the other thing I was going to ask. Yeah. Because I play mostly down a half step. So that would drive you nuts.
Right. So I'm playing A in a A position and, you know, I'm hearing G. So it was just. Felt like I was drunk and everything thereof.
Yeah, that's insane. So how has it helped you? How has it benefited you throughout your music career?
Well, it's helped me. It's helped me, especially with composing, with understanding, the different tonal sonority of the importance of chords. You know, they have a certain sound, for that reason, you know, a D minor chord has a completely different sound than a C sharp minor chord. So understanding what that reference is and being able to attribute that to, you know, a feeling and an emotion, you start to really make the notes one with your inner self. And so you understand things like if you go back and play something that you did a few years back, you were able to identify with what it was, what key it was in, what key with that specific passage was. It helps you with learning stuff. If you want to learn things from ear, from somebody else's, I mean, it helps you when you watch YouTube and somebody uploads a record and they didn't upload it at the correct speed. You can tell that it's not at the right speed.
Right,
I mean,
right.
It just does all kinds of things, you know, it's really pretty intense. You know, I've just learned to accept it. I don't really rely on it. You know, when I played with Dinesh Chambers and Bunny Brunel in the band cab, you know, I was reading charts every night. So it just wouldn't really, it wouldn't matter what key the songs were in.
Right.
But it just, it really did when it came to taking solos, because then I could not look at the charts, you know, and just really focus on playing off of the chords and, you know, the tensions and different things like that.
Right. So what about when you're listening to, you know, like you said, songs at the wrong speed, thinking of like Stone in Love by Journey is one that comes to mind, and a lot of early Van Halen and AC/DC, where they may not have necessarily been in tune. What is that like for someone with perfect pitch?
It's rough. Yeah.
Are those pitches that you can distinguish, or is it just like chaos?
Yeah. So you can distinguish them. Yeah. It's pretty rough, and it's hard to really, yeah, it's hard to become one with something that doesn't really quite sound the way it should, you know. That was always my biggest dilemma with piano, because, you know, most pianists can't have a piano tuner at their beck and call,
right?
You know, and these instruments are slipping out all the time, you know, but you have to get past that just to be able to put in, you know, at least your 4 or 5 hours a day, you know. Yeah. And especially at a music conservatory, that's what you that's what you run into, because, you know, you got kids banging on the piano all day long. It's not going to be in tune for you by the time you get there.
Yeah.
But yeah, you know, with guitar, I could finally take out all my tuning revenge and all the bad instruments I was stuck with. So
yeah, exactly. My last question about perfect pitch is, how and when did you discover that you had it?
Oh, my parents did. My dad played piano, and I used to copy the stuff that he he would play. You know, I would do my best attempt at it, but he was really good, and he just couldn't understand how I was doing it. So he would play these things.
Yeah, that would have been nuts.
Yeah.
As a parent.
And that's how I got started at 5. Yeah. And so they got me started because I was copying him a lot. And I think he was kind of annoyed with it.
Nice. I wanted to ask you a little bit about your writing process for instrumental music in particular.
Mm. Okay. Well, there's no... What I try to do... I think it's just very organic. You know, I have an approach where... one thing won't work for the next thing, if you know what I'm saying. You know, sometimes I might start with a drum groove, or sometimes I might start with a bass groove, but sometimes I might hear a whole complete piece, or sometimes a guitar thing or a keyboard thing. And then I can't say I write on keyboards all the time or guitar. It's I just go after whatever the feeling is. I mean, sometimes, you know, it's funny that you might play something on a piano and then switch over to a Rhodes and it seems right, you know, or you try to play it with a clean sound on a guitar and it doesn't seem right. So I think, you know, the instrumentation has a lot to do with how you're going to be motivated to complete this project. And that's kind of the way I approach it. There's just no one thing that I do. I just try many different things to try to, you know, to try to keep the creativity flowing.
Right. Like whatever grabs you.
Whatever grabs me. Exactly. Yeah. And sometimes it can be just, you know, one of the things I really like particularly about writing now is, you know, in this period, I mean, of where computers are at and stuff, you know, with, you know, DAW stations and all, is that, you know, you can write things pretty much, in a MIDI format to get used to what you feel like is the right tempo of something, which is something I love, because one of the things I do is start with a sketch of something. For instance, if I put it together, I start with the sketch and I'll slow it down, speed it up, change the key, this kind of thing, you know, just for the flick of a switch, which you couldn't do before. Right. Yeah. And so then I'm like, wow, this sounds really cool. Then I'll start building it. Then when I get, you know, hands on the actual, you know, piano or the actual guitar, then you start, it becomes a project. It becomes something that, you know, you only have to complete. It's like a mission.
Right. Yeah. And that's something that I think a lot of, particularly old school guys that seem to be kind of anti-technology may not see is, it can be a source of inspiration.
Oh, big time. Yes. Because, you know, now I can write on the plane, you know,
yeah,
I have this little keyboard that I pull out sometimes, and I plug it into my, you know, my MacBook, and I just start working on some ideas, and it's just amazing. People next to me think I'm crazy, but, you know, they don't know what I'm doing.
Yeah, Elvis Costello wrote a few songs on the plane in that documentary, that the Bob Dylan documentary, and that was pretty cool. It was like he went to the bathroom running in there and, you know, had to do a little recording of his vocal and stuff like that. So it's very cool that you can do that now.
It's true. I can see how he does it, because, you know, you realize, you know, if you're on an 8-hour flight or 9, 10 or whatever, which I am a lot, you know, you realize, wow, there's just like a lot of time wasted sitting here.
Right.
You know,
right.
I'm not tired, so let me just try to be creative.
Sure. A little iPhone. Exactly.
That leads perfectly into my next question, which was, how do you stay creative and inspired? I mean, after doing this for so many years, where does that creativity and inspiration come from for you?
Well, for me, it comes from really associating myself with these these great players, for instance, this drummer and that I'm working with now, Gergo Borlai from Hungary, just really tremendous piano player, tremendous drummer, just unbelievable, you know, and being around people with this energy level really is something that's like fuel. Just being around other players that have that type of drive, you know, that type of thing. I try to associate myself at least with that. And then also there's, you know, taking a healthy, you know, absence from it occasionally. Sometimes I have to do that. Sometimes I might go on a 2 or 3 day motorcycle, you know, ride.
Sure.
You know, I do that. I'll go up north or something, or sometimes I'll go to Las Vegas and it has nothing to do with music, you know?
Right.
And then I come back and I have a whole fresh, you know, approach of it. And it's just, I think you got to have balance, you know, with it. And for me anyway, in my opinion, there's a balance to it.
I agree. Yeah, for sure. So you mentioned being driven and determined, and I mean, we all know music is a survival game more than anything else. What would you say to younger players to keep them kind of churning and burning?
Well, for one, I was lucky because my first teacher, Marian Jensen, always put this in my head. And it's funny, when I got the heart, Raymond Hansen put that in my head too, that you can have no expectations. You should have no expectations. You can have desires, but you can't expect anything to happen out of anything that you're trying to do. But if these things happen, that's wonderful, because that's, you know, that's a great thing.
Yeah.
But I think when people get into it with going, oh, I'm just going to be, you know, this great drummer or this wonderful singer, and I'm going to win this voice competition, you know, that's not a healthy way to start, because as soon as that doesn't happen, you know, and I've known a lot of wonderful players that have run into that type of discouragement, you know, all the air comes out of, you know, their drive, and then they lose everything that they have. So you really got to have a love for it. And if you have a love for it, then you can really make incredible things happen. That's the truth.
Yeah. That's a good point about seeing competitions, is it becomes more about winning and what are you, you know, that's not what music is about. Absolutely. There's no, you know, winning. It's, you know, success is the artist, you know.
Exactly. And it happens for so many reasons. And a lot of times it's not even reasons that, you know, we fully understand what they are, because a lot of times it's just timing and, you know, being in the right place or writing the right song, or, you know, it's not really about always about how good or fast or tall or short or anybody is, or, you know, to be a model or, you know, to be a weightlifter or to be anything. It's just timing, really.
Yep. And luck, like we were talking about earlier.
Yes. But along the way, I mean, you'll have to have the seeds. And that was always taught to me too. I mean, you got to have something that somebody or somewhere can foster.
Right.
Somebody can make that grow. I mean, if that's not there, then you're wasting everybody's time, including, you know, yourself, because I'm sorry, your own time, because really it there's going to be ups and downs. You know, I played sports too, you know, forever. So, you know, a lot of basketball. So there's no coach that's going to tell you you're going to win every freaking game you play. You're going to have times when you're going to sit there and cry in a locker room, you know, it's going to happen.
Yeah.
So it's like that with music.
Yeah. Yeah. It's about how many hits you can take and stay in the ring. Right.
Exactly. It really is.
That's how someone put it to me one time. And I thought that was one of the best ways you could put it.
It's exactly it. That's it.
So you've been a part of so many projects. What stands out? I mean, over a huge career with all these projects under your belt, what stands out? What are some of your favorites that you've been a part of?
Well, I'm not a favoritism individual. I never really quite was. So, I mean, everything was very unique, everything that I did, and everything was really very different and almost unrelated to each other on the different things that I did. I think the biggest thing that stands out is, like, you know, all the wonderful friends that I've made, you know, over all the years that I've been doing what I've been doing, and they're still there. You know, I mean, I'd known Steve Vai years before I ever played with him, you know, and it's stories like that. I remember meeting Lenny White when I was 14, you know, so it's all those types of things that, you know, and people just tend not to forget. You know, I recorded with Chick Corea on the very last Cab record we did, Theater of, you know, the Marionettes. Just being able to just do different things and just put my best into it. And people always remember that, you know, hey, when he comes to work, you know, he comes with 180%, not just enough to get by. Yeah. And I think that's good. I think that's good. And I like to work with people like that have that same ideal. It's not that I consider myself better than anybody. I just, you know, I remember particularly my teacher. I always remember everything that they say, but I remember once, you know, he told me, he goes, don't be that guy that goes to the show that's unprepared. You don't want to be that guy.
Yeah.
Always be overprepared.
Yeah.
And so, and that's just the thing that I always do. I'm always, I just beat it up, you know.
Yeah.
I have to learn, you know, get ready for rehearsals. For me, getting ready for rehearsals is like getting ready for a show.
Yeah.
I have to know everything.
Yeah. Preparation. You never want to be the weak link.
Yeah. Preparation shows your confidence too. You know, when you walk in and you're prepared, it's, there's nothing like having confidence, you know, when you walk into the gig.
Yeah, it's true. But sometimes people get the wrong idea about what that is because, you know, people, you know, sometimes ask me to play on these sessions, you know, and they send me these stuff and they're like, oh, send that to him. He can play it. And I hear this shit. I'm like, how did you write this?
Right.
You played this on a keyboard with two hands and you want me to play this on the guitar? Come on, get out of here. Yeah. Rewrite it.
It's like, let's be a little realistic here.
Yeah, exactly.
So in my opinion, you have definitely found a very unique voice on the guitar. How would you suggest others find their own unique voice instead of maybe falling into the trap of copying someone else?
Well, when I came on, it, you know, when I was growing up and then when I was learning music, you actually had to read the music. So, I mean, this was a big difference because we didn't really have any of the stuff that we had today. We had nothing like that. The accordion was a popular instrument, you know, you don't see it anymore. People were playing piano and girls were taking dance lessons and some guys that went on to be great in, you know, dancing, you know, you don't see those art schools anymore. You really don't see that as much anymore. What you see now are just really, there's a lot of media, which is a wonderful thing if you use it correctly.
Yeah.
But if, you know, you went to a show, it was really the only way that you were going to see a band play live. Now you don't have to do that. You can just go to YouTube or whatever and see these bands play live. So what's happening is I think you kind of are overindulging your mind with a little too much of the fast food. I think that that's what happens. And everybody kind of, it's like McDonald's. Everybody goes, you know, eats the bad stuff, you know. To be fresh, you got to treat everything like you almost have never heard it before.
Right.
And you've got to have that kind of freshness in what you're trying to do. And I've noticed that consistency with a lot of people, you know, that I've met, like, you know, Frederick Dordendale, all these great players, you know, they don't really listen to a lot of people. I mean, there's, right. if you listen to a lot of, if an actor listens to a lot of somebody else, you know, reading the lines is going to sound just like that guy.
Right.
So that's just what's going to happen. At least with what I was doing, I had an escape route when I got a little older, you know, I could still spend a lot of time reading, you know, piano music and investigating music.
Yeah.
I think that's a wonderful thing because there's nothing that any of these musicians are doing today, honestly, that hasn't been covered, you know?
Yeah.
You know, by Saint-Saëns, Debussy, really, you know, Prokofiev, you know, really all of these things have been done. And it's just amazing when you go back and listen to that, you can get wonderful inspiration from that. And I'm not saying you shouldn't go, yeah, have a favorite band or something, but when it becomes obsessive and you want to have that exact same sound, well, yeah, that's not going to be very helpful for you or your future.
Right. Unless you were in a tribute band for that band.
Well, that makes me
mad.
That
only goes so far.
And those guys make so much money, man, doing that. I've thought about it a few times.
The tributes? Oh, you've thought about it?
I'm kidding.
Okay. I was about to say, because I did a Journey tribute and a Alice in Chains tribute, and both of those
were it's amazing.
Very, very eye-opening experiences, and I am done with the tribute scene for sure.
There you are, huh?
Yeah.
That's good.
You can only put on the wig so many times. We had another person we interviewed that said, you know, if you want to put on the wig, you know, that's your dignity. That's your thing.
So, that's funny.
Yeah.
That's great.
That was actually Kelly Lemieux said that, the bassist. Oh,
that's great.
And I was just like, yeah, you're totally right. Like, and that wasn't what made me quit. I've been done for a while, but still it was like, man, that kind of always sat weird with me. Do you have any opinion on tributes talking about this? I mean, you kind of mentioned it, but.
No, I mean, I don't, but you know, when I go to Vegas, I see a lot of tribute bands. It's pretty interesting. It's like, you know, you see it all out there.
It's kind of the tribute mecca.
it really is. It's amazing. And they look like these guys, you know?
Yep. Yeah. Man, that's crazy. What are some of the more mm-hmm. like, I guess, quote, famous tributes you've seen?
Oh, well.
Or better, however, whatever word you want to say.
Well, we don't want to say the Elvis thing. I've seen that, of course. I've seen a Van Halen copy band in Holland once. It was just unreal. I thought it was Van Halen.
Wow.
It was really amazing.
That's pretty awesome.
I've seen a Weather Report band in Europe.
Oh, nice. That's cool.
That these guys looked the part. I mean, too, you know, this guy had this Zawinul look and the Jacob Pastorius thing, you know? Yeah. It's really amazing.
Yeah. That's interesting. But
they weren't hacks, you know, they really could play.
Right. Sure. Well, you have to be able to play that stuff.
Yeah. Well, that's the amazing thing. But, you know, there's not such a big market to be in a Weather Report copy band, you know, you could imagine because, you know, but they were doing it well and doing it, just keeping it to life. So
there's
soldiers for the cause.
Yeah, absolutely. And I guess for that, with, you know, Jaco passing and all that stuff, that kind of makes more sense to me than, for example, like I said, we did the Journey tribute and that kind of felt like it definitely kind of felt cheap in a way, like you're kind of selling out. And I don't know if you have any thoughts on that.
Well, no, I know those guys in Journey so well because, you know, you got to remember, Steve Smith playing on my very first record and then Neil Sean and then Dean cashing over and ending up in Journey and Steve Smith back in the band again. And it's just, wow. And they were just such amazing, skilled hit makers. You know, I lived in San Francisco for about 12 or 13 years
Journey
at the time. Yeah, when they were doing, I lived in San Rafael, you know, really close to Neil at the time, but they were doing Raised on Radio and this and that. And I was hearing these songs before anybody heard them.
That's what, late 80s, 88, I think?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I remember, recording at, I can't remember, the studio over in Berkeley that was going to close and it's open again. Well, anyway, they did a lot of stuff there. We did, I just heard so much of that stuff. And, I think aside from it all, it was really the timing that made it such original. The timing when it came out is really what made it really what it was. To have somebody do it again today doesn't really quite mean the same thing because it's not the same time period. And that's kind of what I felt when I see some of these bands. I mean, you know, when I watched Van Halen years and years and years ago, for instance, the first time I saw him was at the Worcester Centrum and pretty close to, you know, my house when I was growing up. I had no idea how, you know, for instance, Eddie was playing anything.
Right.
I didn't really know what it was. I mean, I went to a music store and I was trying to play Eruption with just my left hand.
Yeah.
It was like, you know, the C sharp, the E and hammering on the E.
I think Greg Howe had a similar story about how you only had ears, you know, you didn't have eyes on the stuff. So you had no idea.
Exactly. And I'm just like, wow, this guy, it's just, he's got iron hands. This is ridiculous to be able to do that.
Yeah.
And I realized what it was. And I was like, wow, kind of, almost helps in a way if you don't see them.
Right. Yeah. It would have been a better player if you had not, you know, cheated and used the right hand.
It's funny.
Exactly. Yeah. The tribute thing is interesting. And Journey, of course, you know, fantastic band. I mean, I have not really met anyone that doesn't like Journey. It's weird. I mean, the hardest rock guys would come out to shows and love, you know, open arms. Like, and it was just, it was weird to see, you know, all the way up to the most proficient guitar players like yourself, you know, loving Journey. And it's just, they're so universal.
You know, when I moved to Los Angeles, I think in the 90s, and I worked with Steve Perry on about five songs and nothing became of it, but we worked on a lot of songs. He would come over to, I had this place over in outside of Whittier, and he would come by there and we would just sing these ideas. And it all sounded like Journey stuff to me. But, you know, the weird part about it is it's just that he just sounded like himself without anything, without any, like, you know, pitch shifting, that's without any crazy effects, without anything, just sitting in this little studio that we used to work at. And it just really made it almost like I really couldn't contribute the way I should because I was just enamored by the sound, you know? So, yeah, I just love their stuff. You know, I really thought they were amazing and I still do.
Yeah, absolutely. And the more I dove into kind of their history, the more I realized that Steve was that Journey sound, you know, and I mean, everybody knows that on the surface, but you dig a little deeper and you realize that he was responsible for a lot of what they were.
He really was. I mean, you know, I mean, granted, there's stories about how everybody might have function around him or the way they might function altogether. I don't know.
Yeah,
the inability,
they definitely had their share of drama.
Yeah, but even now. For what it was, the magic was what it was, you know. I mean, really, it was definitely in a voice.
Exactly. So speaking of recording, I wanted to talk about the Death of Roses recording process. Could you walk us through that a little bit? It's an absolutely fantastic album. I love
Thank
every
you very,
track,
very but, much. Thank
I,
you very
I'd
much.
Love to
I really
kind of
appreciate
dig into
it.
That.
Okay. Well, when I wrote those songs, really, when I was sidetracked, I was sick for a while. and really had to stay creative. And one of the things I did was just think a lot about, you know, music, because I really wasn't playing for, you know, almost a year. But anyway, I got into it and started really just, you know, hearing ideas and, you know, thinking about ideas, and then picked up a smaller computer and I started really just trying to put things together, certain ideas. And so the record came together. It really, really did. In record time, I mean, for lack of a better expression, it came together pretty quick. They just felt natural. And I think part of it was because I had so much time away that I really had a fresher
Look. Going back to the inspiration creativity talk we were
talking. Yeah, that's kind of what it was. And then, of course, the musicians that I worked with, you know, on the record, you know, Mikis Gurko was just fabulous. And Pete Griffin and I worked together for quite a long time. And it was really the type of thing that it was a very natural process. It wasn't, there just wasn't a lot of technology, if you know what I'm saying, involved in putting it together. We really almost did it the old way, you know. I mean,
that's really interesting because it came out in 2017, correct? Last year? I know it was really recent. I just didn't know if it was this year or last year.
Yeah, but we just, when I worked with him, you know, my regular engineer, Adair Doffenbach, and we just retracted everything really as if the, you know, the DAW station was a tape machine, you know, going through that approach where if we didn't like the take, we would just do a whole run again. We would just try to get everything.
Okay.
Just to try to get it to somewhere realistic, because this record was completely different. It wasn't really a record built with a lot of motifs, if you know what I mean. You know, it was really, you know, like hundreds of thousands and songs like that, you know, and that record, Maximum Security, has a lot of songs built with a lot of, you know, motif ideas, you know, it's short runs and short phrases that keep repeating itself. That wasn't really the case. There's a few songs on this record that do that, but that's just really not how they were put together, because from verse to verse, they're played differently. And so there was a freedom, you know, with really just being able to let the thing grow. And we went at it that way and said, you know, heck it, there's no rules. Let's just let's make it that way. And that's really pretty much how the record was. And I had more songs that I wrote, but I decided to release it as an EP. And we are working on the remainder of these songs to come out later on the second half.
Well, that'll be awesome. I can't wait for that.
So, yeah, me too.
So what's advice would you give young musicians who are really interested in odd meters? I mean, you play in odd meters really proficiently, and I'd love to hear your advice for helping others do the same.
Well, I always say that, you know, music is really all about an understanding, and what better way to understand things than to understand how certain composers wrote things in odd meters. So if you listen to modern music, you can really start to understand it. If you listen to Stravinsky, let's just pick something. I don't want to listen to Petrushka. If you listen to something like this, you can understand how odd meter doesn't sound odd meter. It sounds very common.
Right.
Because, you know, you're writing over the, you know, over the bar line. And you can, when you can understand that, then you, it's a source of big inspiration for your own material. If you listen to another band really do it, and you're listening to their, you know, their definition, you know, orally of what they think it is, you know, and it really shouldn't be that. You should understand first the concept of what it is. And then you'll see that these different things don't really matter because odd meter can seem very square. It can seem very much like 4/4. It's kind of one of the things that I did with the, you know, Chrome Castles. Chrome Castles is a tune on my record. It has starts, I think it's 5/5/8. Type thing, and it doesn't feel that way, only because I started in the second half of the third bar, and the general melodic thing comes around in the introduction.
Okay,
but you know, I mean, you just really got to go about it, you know, your own way. There's no rules, really. There's not any rules, and there's so many cool things that drummers, non-drummers can do these days. They can work with, you know, all these different DAW stations have all these different drum programs where you can create these drums, you know, very quickly and, you know, and change the feel of what they feel like. And you can play. I think the battle is, or the trick is to try to make things feel as if they're an even beat over an odd meter thing. And that's very cool to do.
Right. Keep that back kind of head bobby, so to speak.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So you use, I think we saw this on your website. You use TuneTrack products, Superior Drummer, I'm assuming.
No, I don't. I just, all I wrote with on the, on this, the last couple of records that I have used is created everything with Logic and then did all the guitars with Pro Tools.
Oh, okay. Nice. Okay, cool. So you have a lot of great endorsements. I'm sure you've accumulated over the years of playing. How would you suggest younger musicians go about getting endorsements? Obviously, when you know the time is right to do so, you can't get an endorsement right out of the gate. I think everyone understands that. But when the time is right, what would you suggest to the upcoming
generation? Well, I would say that, you know, we obviously live in a media age right now, so utilize YouTube and make videos and do that sort of thing and get those videos to the, you know, to the guitar and amp A&R guys so they can see you. And maybe they'll talk about you coming to the NAMM show and, you know what I mean? Playing at, right. At a booth or doing some kind of, you know, video or maybe getting an amp at really a cut price and doing a complete demonstration with a product. There's so many cool things that these players today can do, you know, that those kind of things weren't really available to us. You know, people more or less, you know, gave you gear, you know, to use. And then you found out that you couldn't really take these amps on tour with you because they weigh too much and you couldn't get them on the plane. So, You know, so there's a lot to do with the realistic approaches of, you know, taking advantage of the media today. Nowadays, for instance, I'm using it's been since the 90s. I've been using HK stuff, but I'm using the really small, I was using the Core Blades on the last tour. And on this tour, so we're starting out in South America. I'm using the really small Grandmeisters. And basically, I'm going on the road with, an iPad. And so it the iPad has all the whole show on it, and you just upload that to the amps. And that's it. And the amps are provided there. Yeah, and I was doing almost the same thing with the Core Blades, except, you know, they were very heavy. And so they were provided as backline, especially when I did things with PSMS and then also my last tour. You just use a memory stick, a USB stick. But you can't really change the parameters of everything as much with that. But you can't really change the parameters of anything with that. But you can with the iPad, with the Grandmeister. So I would say, yeah, for the younger players and the older players that are starting out late, just definitely, do some YouTube videos. It's great.
Yeah.
So have you ever used the Kemper or the Axe-FX Fractal?
Never. I heard it, but I'm really an old school tube guy. You know, because, you know, this HK stuff is all tubes. And I just, you know, there's something to me about, I don't know, solid state, it just doesn't have the same feel to me. It's just me, you know.
Sure.
Just,
yeah, that's the biggest thing, I think, is feel.
Yeah, I can't really control it.
Which is very individual. Well,
yeah, it's really, really hard for me to control it.
It's funny. People argue so passionately one way or the other. I don't think it matters. I think it's whatever, you said it best, whatever feels right to you, you know?
Oh, yeah, exactly. Exactly. So, that's where I stand with that. I'm a tube guy.
Nice.
I'm with you on that one.
Yeah, kind of like that. In that same realm of conversation, digital versus analog. I mean, that's a huge debate we hear all the time. Are you standing on the analog side of the fence or digital or kind of both, or what are your thoughts?
What do you mean with audio?
Sure. Yeah. Audio.
With records and things. And absolutely. Well, definitely digital.
We're talking about recording or listening or what?
Oh, for both. I mean, I hated CDs and I hated cassettes even worse and records. CDs always turn out to be like ashtrays, or people give them to you and you don't want to carry it around. And
yes,
this electronic stuff is just amazing. It's just great to have, you know, you get in your car or on your motorcycle and you got all these tunes that you can listen to, you know, right off of your phone.
Yeah.
I mean, I can send people like, here's a demo of this song instantly. I mean, that's just really, it's terrific.
If anyone hands me a CD now, I don't have a way to play it. So I cannot listen to it. I don't know what to do with it because all the stuff is wireless.
Isn't that amazing? I know. I'm always like, what do you want me to do with this thing? I can't talk.
And how fast that came. You
know, I used to be able to play them on my car, but the CD player just stopped working. So there you go. That says enough about it right there.
Yeah. But I remember how painstakingly hard we worked on some of those early records. Like, you know, I'm doing some shows with Vinnie Moore coming up in Japan. And we're going to do some of the older things we did, you know, together when I played on some of his records. And, you know, he's going to, you know, help me with some of the things I did. You know, it's going to be great. We're going to have fun. But, you know, we were talking about, gosh, it was amazing how hard we had to work with these, you know, we're battling these 24-track Studer machines. you know, and they're synced together. And I remember one time the machines started going opposite of each other and the tape got stretched because they had little drums on one tape. And, you know, it was that. They'd start again. Nothing you can do. Which
yeah. yeah. Jeez.
You know, that's it's completely destructive recording, you know. Yeah. And it's amazing when you work today, you really can't make a mistake. You know, it's like
lots of undo.
I mean, cause you can always get backwards and go, where is this? Even if your computer shuts off and you didn't save it, you can find the file somewhere in the bin. Yeah. It's pretty amazing. Yeah. I really think it's really out there.
Yeah, absolutely. So going back a little bit to when we were talking earlier about you being, you know, 180% always prepared, ready to go at rehearsals. Does that tie over into you filming shows or recording rehearsals or anything like that to kind of listen back and do the football tape review, so to speak?
No, I mean, I don't listen. I don't like my voice even on an answering machine. Thank God those are out of style now. I don't listen. I just know because I have trusted people that tell me whether or not it was, you know, decent or halfway decent or something, but I don't really, it psychs me out really to watch or to hear myself. I just never really got into it, but I can feel it. I know when I'm doing something, you know, that I should be doing. And I think that kind of leads to it. But, you know, along with it, I did leave it out. Practicing and writing has a peak time to it, you know, and it has, you know, it has a birth time, as my teacher used to say, and it has a peak time. So if you begin practicing something too soon, you know, in lieu of the fact that when you might have to do something at a specific date, you know, you might get too good at when you did it, and then you kind of lose this feeling of just like, you know, really owning it. Like there's a time when you're learning something, or studying something, there's a point of time when you almost feel like you have it and you're not sure. And then there's a time when you have it that you got to be kind of in between there, because it's like not thinking about music that just really makes you, you know, react and be musical instead of thinking about it. And that's not the same thing as reacting to it. So that's what I find. I don't like, if I have a session to do or something, I mean, I won't, you know, if it's in like 3 months from now, I'm not going to start now. I'll start, in about, you know, a few weeks before it, I'll listen to it, but I won't start learning anything. Mm-hmm. But oftentimes listening to it for me is learning it, because I can see where everything should be. But then I'll start to, you know, the wonderful thing about the guitar is that there's more than, I used to talk about this with Lukather, there's more than one way to play things, you know? So if you heard somebody do something, if you can really hear how they really did it, judging by how the strings sound, you know, you kind of know where they did it. But when you play it live, you might want to try something in a different way. So when you hear somebody that gives you a demo, you know, of something, you just have all these different ways to play it.
Right.
All right. So one of the things that I do when I explain this in clinics, I explain this in the John Petrucci camp that I did last time, but we're going back to do that again, is that I learn all of my stuff in different places because, you know, it eliminates the error. If you only do it in one place, you know, then that's all you really got down. You know, you put your hand in a different place, you go up, a few frets and you can formulate it with the different strings. But if you haven't really practiced it out, you know, it might not be inside picking here. You might be in trouble there. You might sound like an idiot.
Right.
So what I do is I try to practice on the guitar in all these different ways. That's one of the ways that I really become familiar with everything that's going on a seven string neck. You know, that's kind of what I do on a keyboard. You're not dealing with that. The only thing you're dealing with is fingering, and there's only one way to play it.
So, right. You know. Yeah. Guitar, obviously, like you said, many ways to play things. And that's really good advice, because that is a more musical approach to my thinking than just learning boxes and shapes. And, you know, anyone could do that. You know, you want to learn it in different places, and it opens up different things. Right.
You're exactly right. That's the truth. I mean, it's an amazing thing. I mean, when you watch Holdsworth play, you know, I went to see him once, you know, so he was a good friend, and I saw him play at the Syntax once somewhere. I don't know where it was. And you know, I was sitting in the front row, and you remember that thing, all these little E strings or something. and you can watch him play, and you have no idea what he's doing. It's like watching somebody play that's like playing a flipped over guitar. You can't figure out what he's doing, because he doesn't really, you know, there's not that much excessive motion. He doesn't make a big, you know, who to do about what he's doing. It's just very calmly, you know, taking you apart with everything he's doing, you know, and it's really totally amazing. And I remember him once saying to me, he goes, "Hey, Tony, you want to come up and you want to play this a bit?" And I go, "No, I'm absolutely fine right here in this chair. Thank you very much." Yeah. I'm going to stay right here.
Yeah, that's kind of where you want to be at a Holdsworth concert, in the crowd.
Stay in the chair behind your beer.
Don't make a fool of yourself.
Don't do that.
Even the mighty Tony McAlpine.
Yeah, you got it, brother.
So who is... I like asking this next question because we hear a lot of especially old school stuff about how music was so great, you know, back in the day. Obviously it was, but I think we also have a lot of great music now. Who are some of your favorite current musicians, guitarists, bands, whatever comes to mind about current music, current, you know, the last couple years, whatever, just, you know, not 1994 or whatever.
Oh, well, that's a good question. I really like what Jason Richardson, stuff that he's doing. You know,
he's fantastic. Really, did you meet him at the Petrucci thing? I know he was there too.
Yeah, he was there too. You know, Frederick Dordendale. Yeah. There's just so many, you know, players. Tosin's amazing. You know, there's just so many cool players, you know.
Yeah, one of the ones we like a lot is the Winery Dogs. They're really awesome. As, you know.
Yeah.
So, Totson, you know, next level.
Oh yeah. Yeah, he's we did some shows with Richie's solo band.
Oh, cool.
Down in San Diego somewhere.
Very cool.
He's just terrific. You know, just there's just so many great players.
He's another one of those guys like you that he's got, you know, piano chops, guitar chops, and can sing. Like, it's ridiculous. Oh, yeah. Man,
I just did a show with my drummer and Stu Ham, and also this Indian bass player, Mohini Day.
Mohini Day, yeah, she's amazing.
We did a whole set with her and
cool.
Wow. You know, it's incredible. And, you know, and how old are you? I'm 21. Great. Let me go. Jump off a building now.
Actually, now that you mentioned that, I remember seeing Stu post about that on Instagram. I do remember seeing that.
Yeah. Unreal.
Man,
she was just incredible.
Yeah. And I heard about her through Steve Vai. She played on a Steve Vai song on one of his, I guess his newest record.
Yeah, she did. And she played with Guthrie on some stuff and, you know, yeah, plays with Marco and some other things. Yeah. She's really tremendous.
That's crazy. So kind of wrapping up here with just a few more questions. What did you want to promote? What do you have going on? Where can we send people to go see what you're all about and become a lifelong fan like me?
Go to the website, TonyMcAlpine.com, always. And there's a wealth of information there. And it has all the concert dates going on, when we're going to be in, you know, your neck of the woods. And also information on, you know, where you can pick up, you know, where you can pick up records and tapes and 8-track tapes and all kinds of different things. So, yeah, the website is definitely the place. TonyMcAlpine.com is definitely where you want to check it out. And it's got all the things, the things that are that I'm about to do that are coming up again. I'm going to the next Petrucci camp. Looking forward to that. And just all kinds of things.
You kind of just answered it. But what can we expect from you in the future? I mean, even further in the future than what you just said.
Well, the next thing is the new record should be ready to go with that in about three or four months. I think we're going to be making some good noise with that right now.
Does it have a name yet?
No, it doesn't. Okay. It's just still in the growing stages. Yep. You know, I write things, people record them, and I say they're bad. So we start.
It's a slow process.
Yeah, it is a very slow process.
Worth it in the end, though. All right, Tony, man, thank you so much for being on the show, for real. I think so much to learn in this episode, and I think our listeners are going to get so much out of what you have to say, so I can't thank you enough.
Yep.
Well, thank you very much for having me. I really had a great time. I love the questions. It just feels so natural just to sit here and rap with you about, you know, all these things that we have in common, you know.
Yeah, absolutely, really, man. That's what it's all about. It's not about, you know, I always use this as an example, but what gauge strings you play. Like, it's not about that kind of stuff. We like to go a little more macro, a little more abstract, and give advice that people can really latch onto and make, you know, life-changing things with.
Yeah, I loved it. Thank you very much. I had a great time.
All right, Tony. Thanks so much, man. And we will talk to you soon. Hey, guys. First of all, thank you so much for listening. If you could please take a quick moment to subscribe on iTunes and leave a rating and review. Your feedback seriously is really important, and it helps us keep the show alive.
Check out musicianstalkshow.com to sign up for our mailing list. If you do, we're going to send you our main theme song and a few other surprises. Plus, you'll always be the first to know what episodes are coming up.
If you want to help support the show so we can keep putting out the highest quality content possible, please follow the Support the Show link at our website and consider donating to our Patreon page.
Lastly, if you have an idea for a guest or a question you want to discuss, contact us through any of the contact forms on our website, and we'll do everything we can to make it happen.
Whew, all right. That was a lot, but we got through it. Thanks again, guys, and we will see you soon.